This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
The town of Eagle Butte is named for the most significant geological feature in the area. It's just south of town, Wanblee Paha, or Eagle Butte. Historically, it was where indigenous peoples were known to trap eagles for use in ceremony. They would dig a hole or build a stone pit, and then cover the opening with a lattice of leaves or grass, then bait the trap with small game and lay in wait. Patience was a prerequisite. The Cheyenne River Sioux Reservation was founded in 1891. It was the result of the Sioux Act that carved the Great Sioux Reservation into six distinct parts. Reservation headquarters was originally at Cheyenne River Agency. Now, that was a small community on the western bank of the Missouri River. In the early 20th century, unallotted land was sold and developed into town sites like Parade, Dupree, and Eagle Butte. Then in the 1950s, as work began on the Pick-Sloan plan for damming the upper Missouri River, it wouldn't be long before the old Cheyenne River Agency was inundated under Lake Oahe. So in advance, Eagle Butte, a majority white town at the time, lobbied the tribe to move their headquarters. Citing the central location along Highway 212, the tribal council approved the plan and moved the agency, as well as the families displaced by the dam, all to the new capital right around 1955. Eagle Butte received an economic boost from the agency relocation, though many tribal members felt more was lost than gained as a result of the Pick-Sloan Missouri dams and lakes. From the start, though, there have been local efforts to turn those losses into gains, to transform this town beneath Wanblee Paha into a hub for homegrown indigenous innovation. And that's part of our story that you're going to see. And welcome to Dakota Life and greetings from Eagle Butte.
This program is made possible with support from the Cheyenne River Sioux Tribe Telephone Authority, keeping people connected for over 60 years, and by the Four Bands Community Fund, helping people in the Eagle Butte area build strong and sustainable businesses and giving back to the Cheyenne River area.
As the people in and around Eagle Butte told us of their community, time and again, the stories were of individuals overcoming adversity, rising in their field, and becoming a leader, but directing their accomplishment towards the betterment of their family, back to the community or the tribe. And what better example than one of Eagle Butte's and Cheyenne River's most revered elders, the late and extraordinary Marcella Lebeau. Born in 1919, she was the great-granddaughter of legendary fool soldier Joseph Forebear. Ms. Lebeau faced her share of adversity too, attending a boarding school where her language and expressions of her culture were forbidden. Still, she answered the call to serve her country during World War II in the U.S. Army Nurse Corps. She saved the lives of troops wounded storming the beaches at Normandy on D-Day and many other crucial battles. Lebeau received many honors over the years, including France's highest civilian award, the Legion of Honor. Her life as a Native American servicewoman inspired people around the world, but that's only the beginning. After the war, she treated patients on the Cheyenne River Reservation, rising through the ranks to Director of Nursing at Eagle Butte Indian Health Services. She served on the Tribal Council, helped organize the Oahe Landowners Association, fought for fair compensation for tribal members who lost land to the impoundment of Lake Oahe. She spoke before Congress in support of a bill rescinding the Medals of Honor awarded to participants in the Wounded Knee Massacre. Lebeau was a recipient of the Women in History Award, given by the Spirit of the Prairie chapter of the Daughters of the American Revolution, and she was inducted into the South Dakota Hall of Fame. At the age of 102, Marcella Lebeau, in the words of her family, passed on to journey to the next world. Her memory is part of the fabric of Eagle Butte, as it is at home and abroad to anyone who ever had the privilege to meet her. Today, younger voices are speaking up, and some of them have a local platform on the airwaves in a 120-mile radius around Eagle Butte. They're part of KIPI Radio, and they keep the Cheyenne River Oyate informed and entertained with a mix of music and talk customized to their unique audience.
Morning.
What we put out as bass affects everybody, and if they're listening, you know, it's going to either help them or that's what they're going to be thinking about during the day. So how do we take this and we positively impact the community?
You're tuned in to KIP on 93.5 with MC Pat.
It really means a lot to me because we're the first commercial radio station in Indian country. So, and a lot of people really don't understand that difference, but it's a lot harder, let me tell you that.
And hopefully everybody out there is taking care of each other. And everybody's having a good morning.
So we get a lot of people calling in, why can't you play this? Why can't you play that? I want to hear our Lakota Olawans, our indigenous songs a lot more. But we have to incorporate it into the programming in a way where we can generate revenue from all sources of South Dakota and the United States. Because we have listeners all over the United States and across the oceans as well.
This is my FM. More music.
Well, the people that I know involved with the start of the business or of the radio station primarily was Thomas Eaglestaff. He was the previous station manager. He's now retired. But it was kind of his goal and vision to bring a radio station, among other people, our executive producer, Seth Peacott, his father, Bill Peacott, was involved. Dana Dupree's, which is a huge cultural and spiritual person for our people, was involved, and they all worked in radio before.
The whole beginning of the radio station was fun. It was imaginative. You know, you could basically do anything almost what you wanted to. You got to play what music you wanted to. You got to cover what subjects you wanted to. So at that time, I realized that I had a way to positively impact the community.
Hey, you're tuned in to KIPI 93.5 FM and HD Radio. This is MC Cloud rolling with the thunder, hit you with the lightning. Next song that's coming up, hey man, it's a cold world out there. Here's a little bit of Maniac, Hoka.
So I like to showcase Native American artists, but I don't put them in one group. I put them with today's top chart numbers because there's Native American art and then there's the rest of pop art and culture. It's a goal that we play a Native American artist every hour, whether that's R&B, country, rock and roll, etc. Just so that these Native Americans have a platform to stand on.
It allows us to include everyone, which really goes connects with our Lakota value system, which is we include everyone and we make space for everyone so everyone's comfortable and happy. Whereas we're doing those same things within the radio station, and it's huge. And I don't know if anybody else is doing it, and we're getting good positive feedback about it. So hopefully we're going down the right direction, because we are actually going to be getting ready to incorporate a community station in our offerings as well. So a lot of the people that want to hear our Lakota Olawans, our traditional songs, they want to hear our council sessions, they want to hear, you know, Grandma Unchi Debbie Day over in Bridger is holding this event. We can go there and play all of the content for the people. So that's going to be a huge, exciting thing. So we're covering everyone. I see us as the top indigenous radio station in the world, you know, and it's to showcase not only our people, but all people. So, super excited.
And you know what? Up next, we have some Nick Jonas here, so don't go anywhere. Keep listening. I'll catch you guys in like 20 minutes or so. Later, taters!
When you're in the area, you can find KIPI at 93.5 FM. If you're out of range, you'll find SDPB radio available from our tallest tower in the network. It's located between Eagle Butte and Faith. Visiting Eagle Butte, one of the first things you'll notice are the large, colorful murals on the walls of businesses and apartment blocks. Many are products of Red Can. It's an annual invitational graffiti jam sponsored by the Cheyenne River Youth Project. Red Can brings in renowned street artists to collaborate with young people on art projects in their communities. The event is internationally known and features music, dance, and art workshops in a variety of mediums. Art and history combine at the Indian Health Service Hospital in Eagle Butte. There are over 400 photos of Native Americans on display. And in the entrance, it was hand-painted by Jim Yellowhawk. Plus, there's a traditional doll by Rhonda Holy Bear. A couple of blocks from the IHS hospital, there's a large mural on an otherwise nondescript former firehouse. This is the latest home of the Wolves Den Boxing Club, which Joe Bringsplenty used to run in his basement. Bringsplenty and his assistant coaches run a holistic program that tends to the mental, physical, and the spiritual health of local youth and adults, training them to build the strength to overcome the challenges of reservation life. Meet Joe, his daughter Belle Bringsplenty, assistant coach Austin Sanchez, and a group of young pugilists in training.
I've read that, you know, boxing is the cockroach of sports because people keep trying to kill it and it keeps coming back, you know, and we were kind of like that too, because we went from different areas, you know, from my home, my basement. You know, I've coached better than 15 kids out of my basement.
All my brothers are boxers, my dad, even my mom boxed a little bit. I know for sure my grandpas were, some of my grandmas. It's just kind of in the bloodline, I guess.
Going back and looking at the area that we had compared to what we have now, I don't know how I did that. You know, it's just, I guess it's just something that I wanted to be able to provide or give as something that was an option to some of the kids in the area here. For the community here, I want to be able to provide that balance because, you know, medication can only go so far, you know, counseling can only go so far, even the spirituality can go so far, and the physical fitness is a part of it too. And it's like what the Zuyawi Chalkag is, it's a program, a diversion program that we created that's a part of our club too, to be able to help troubled youth, to keep them out of prison. Because the fact is that there's a lot of youth here that get caught up in the court system.
I was a ward of the state when I was younger. When I was a young kid, I was really angry. I got in trouble a lot. That led to going to jail often. I ended up going to another group home. And this time my social worker was like, you don't figure your shit out now, I'll keep you in here until you're 18. I'll send you to a boot camp until you're 18. I don't care. I'll send you to juvenile prison until you're 18. Until you figure it out, because this is serious, you know? So I was like, I didn't want that. So you know what, man, I got it together. My social worker was satisfied. I moved back here to South to Eagle Butte, and that's how I met Joe. I met Joe when I was 15 years old, and that was it, man. You know, he took me under his wing, and he became a big part of my life growing up.
For me, at a young age, I learned that it could be used to be able to, you know, balance myself, you know, and, you know, from any anger or issues that I was dealing with and stuff, I can lose myself in maybe a run or bags or boxing.
Ni ta wa chin, ni chatan, ni ta wa nagi. And these are the three things that we practice here in our cultural car and what we do here at the club. And this means mind, body, and spirit. So we truly practice that every day in our life. This is part of that. This is where we get our body strong. And then outside of here, we have a sweat lodge and ceremony that we perform. And that's what strengthens our spirit, you know, every week. You know what I mean? We have lodge just to cleanse the mind and the body and get ready for next week.
It's fascinating because a lot of them, what you teach them, they learn, they take on with them in their life. And they kind of use these skills in life and in boxing. It's just a mixture of, like, good things, and just to be part of their journey in life, it's pretty cool.
You guys gotta watch out for each other.
Yeah.
Keep each other honest.
There's even more about the Wolves Den Boxing Club at sdpb.org/Dakota Life. While the Cheyenne River Tribe was moving its headquarters and relocating residents displaced by Lake Oahe, they did something very simple yet visionary. The tribe purchased the local telephone service and created the Cheyenne River Sioux Tribe Telephone Authority. It was the first tribally owned telephone utility in America. Service was limited in the early years, operating on party lines where several households actually shared a single circuit. Modernization began in the 70s. They started with a new headquarters here in Eagle Butte, and since then, tribes all around the country have followed Cheyenne River's lead and established their own utilities. Meanwhile, CRSTTA has become a rural leader in providing high-speed internet service. But communications is just one arena in which Eagle Butte is a business innovator. Cheyenne River is a place where initiative thrives. And for the past 20 years, the Four Bands Community Fund has been at the forefront of creating opportunity in Eagle Butte and, in fact, all around the state. Whether you dream of owning your own business, want to learn how to manage your money, or simply improve your credit score, Four Bands can help.
I don't remember my parents taking us for Starbucks or, you know, anything fancy like that. I think I just got it on my own, just like iced coffee.
And if you were Kelsey K. Haskell, you couldn't find that in Eagle Butte.
Growing up, there was none in town. There was no place to get a nice coffee, no place to get any fancy drinks. So when I was a freshman, my Aunt Kay bought me an espresso machine. So I used it until it broke.
That was 12 years between friends visiting her house to have a fancy coffee and opening Kelsey K's Coffee Depot. Kelsey had a lot to learn about her personal finances, let alone starting a business. But that's when she met Lakota Vogel and the staff at Four Bands Community Fund.
I have a master's in social work, and everybody said, well, when are you going to do that? And I'm like, this is social work. It's macro level sort of systems change, ensuring that our communities are built right to support entrepreneurship and that we can all pretty much age well in our communities, rural communities specifically.
Lakota is part of a second generation of leadership at Four Bands, whose services continue to evolve to meet community needs.
Started with small dollar loans to artists and still do that, and then expanded to small business lending. From there, you heard a lot of need for home renovations, like we need to renovate our homes. So we created a product there in partnership with First Financial Bank and Dupree, and then moved on to mortgage lending. And that's where we're sort of at in 2019.
Back to the dream of a coffee shop. Kelsey took classes and accepted help from Four Bands on how to manage her money and improve her credit.
I went through them for any kind of coaching that I needed. They offer coaching, they offer financial planning. They do credit building loans for people who don't have credit.
And when her personal house was in order, Four Bands helped her learn how to start and manage a business.
She had this idea. We said, why not test the market and see if we do have a coffee culture here? She was perfect. She was ready at that point, had completed our Create class, which is a 6-week business development course, and she wanted to do it. She was ready to take the risk of seeing if the market would purchase her product, and lo and behold, they did. So.
Well, it was much more difficult than that. First, there was no existing space in downtown Eagle Butte for a coffee shop.
There was no place to buy. I couldn't get my hands on anything. And I've gone through a few different directors at Four Bands from when I started out to now Lakota. And I'm like, Lakota, can you please just build something so I can rent it?
But at the same time, Four Bands was starting a business incubator, a place to try out that coffee shop idea. Finally, in 2019, Kelsey was underway, transitioning to available space that was once a fabric store, then a funeral parlor, and now Kelsey K's Coffee Depot, along with an entirely new learning curve.
I'm a plumber, I'm an electrician, I am an IT person. Yeah, I've learned a lot, and people don't really realize how much you do behind, you know, it looks like it's smooth running, but man, there's some days that I don't even, like I just need a break, just a small break.
Mainly because the coffee shop is doing so well, filling a void in the market with personalized service. The same goes for four bands. They're planning for the future, as is Kelsey.
Very early retirement. No. I want to at least be here long enough to get this paid off. That doesn't necessarily mean me running it forever because I want to be a rancher. I am a rancher now, but I want to be a full-time at-home rancher. So if I could find someone to take over and be me, that would be great. So I could go be with my cows. You know, I just come here for coffee.
I work with entrepreneurs all day. Hope is the bottom line.
From the coffee depot to the Hickory Kitchen restaurant, to helping families expand their herds, buy a home, or gain new business or personal money management skills, Four Bands has had a hand in success stories wherever you travel around in this area. If you travel a few blocks from the KIPI studios, you'll find a state-of-the-art skate park, a local point of pride. A vibrant skating culture has taken root in Native communities across America. In addition to Eagle Butte, skate parks have sprung up in Pine Ridge and Standing Rock. There are new basketball courts in town, and the recently opened 7th Generation Cinemas have increased the range of entertainment available to families. From its Native American roots, there's a growing interest in archery culture all around the country. Ever since Cheyenne Eagle Butte Schools adopted an archery program, student athletes have been on target and rapidly establishing a new South Dakota school sports dynasty.
Since 2012, students at Cheyenne Eagle Butte have been hitting the mark.
It just looked really fun. I was walking by the gym one day after school and I seen them practicing in here and thought I'd join. Did not know that I'd be doing it for 8 years, but it's been pretty fun.
We were looking for, you know, something to add to our physical education unit, and you know, we had a lot of kids that traditionally didn't play basketball, and we wanted to get them involved in school activities. So we come across this program, the Archery in the Schools program, and yeah, it was something that I, you know, picked up, went to some training, and brought it back to my PE class, and then, you know, kind of incorporated it there. So
some naturally picked up the sport.
You know, archery was always something that Native Americans did, and you can see that when kids put a bow in their hands, some of them are natural. You know, we did found out one thing in that early years that it wasn't always the boys that were good archers. It was, you know, some of the girls stepped up, and I don't know how that came out, but we had some very good shooters, you know, some girls. So.
While others needed a little bit more work.
I was not very good when I first started. I got a lot better, though. Started off, I didn't really hit the target a lot. And then Mr. Benoist helped me, got me good, and then I started hitting the target a lot more, got better.
And with that hard work came success, like state championships and trips around the country.
Qualified a couple times for nationals, maybe three times for nationals, two times. So three of those were in Louisville, Kentucky. One I attended was in Sandy, Utah. And just previously, before we shut down for COVID, I know our team attended Utah. It was back in Utah again for a Western Nationals.
But those trips weren't cheap.
Well, you know, besides the community, you know, they've always supported. We've had a lot of different fundraisers. You know, a lot of this takes money to go someplace, you know, trying to get gas money, you know, food and stuff like that. So we had a really good parent support group that put on a lot of different fundraisers and a lot of community members that came in and, you know, they participated, or they come in and bought baked goods. Or, you know, besides the community, it was always part of the, you know, something the tribe always stepped up and helped us with too. So there was a lot of support from this area.
Thanks to those trips to nationals, this program continues to grow and is building to a bright future.
This means a lot. I'm happy that there's more kids that are joining and keeping it going.
Well, I think just seeing, you know, when you come to practice and you see these kids all excited, you know, you're knowing that you've done something that is contributing to something that they feel like they're a successful part of. It's good to see that, and then You know, when we have practices, or when I have practices now, you know, kids come in and, you know, they'll bring a friend, or they'll bring somebody else one time, or, you know, try to introduce somebody else. So I think archery is going to go along a long ways here.
Eagle Butte lives on the border of Dewey and Zeebach counties. It's named for a local landmark, was transformed by the flooding of the former Cheyenne River Agency. People of Eagle Butte aren't strangers to sudden or dramatic change, but have demonstrated how a rural Native American community can not only beat the odds, but lead the way and show other communities, Native and non, how to unlock their potential. With local leaders like Marcella Lebeau and Joe Bringsplenty, they've instilled their own toughness and mental resolve and stand as a role model for us all, but particularly for the next generations. You don't have to strain your eyes to see it. It's on the archery range. It's on the courts. It's in the ring. It's at the skate park and in the murals, at the new businesses, and even underground in the cables connecting Eagle Butte to a bigger world of ideas, and the greater world to the innovation and the resolve here in Eagle Butte. All the while recognizing the commitment to generations. For instance, the Lakota speakers updating the NLD, that's the new Lakota Dictionary phone app, and how the new cinema recognizes the Native seventh generation principle, based on the philosophy that the decisions we make today should result in a sustainable world seven generations into the future. There are visual signs of economic distress in Eagle Butte, but they're overshadowed by a quilt work of tradition and creative attainment rising above that receding flood. You can revisit our stories of Eagle Butte and the other communities we've stopped at this season at sdpb.org/Dakota Life. Thanks for coming along. I'm Larry Rohr. For all of us at SDPB, thanks for watching.